The pages in the history of rock and roll. He's on stage in Scotland this weekend. His name, of course, Robert Plant. We'll be playing music from Led Zeppelin and, of course, the LP Now and Zen, and speaking to Robert for the next 2 hours. He'll join us right after this break. Tom Russell! Interesting story there about last time you were up in Scotland. You were up in the Highlands.
Yeah, I went to the Outer Hebrides. I know it sounds a bit corny, but I was bird watching. Over the years, I'd started watching the migration of birds and stuff. And I went to Barra and North Uist. And then I came back. I was there for about 2 weeks. And then came back through Skye and back down to the chaos of rock and roll again.
What was that this year?
No, it was the year last September.
A couple of years before that, I think it must have been about 3 years ago, I had a barrow load of mail one weekend, umpteen people writing in to tell me they'd bumped into you in Socky Hall Street.
Oh, yeah.
Walking along with a bag full of shopping.
Surely. Oh, well, I don't think it was a bag full of shopping. It was probably a bag full of bottles of whiskey. Yeah. I was having a... It was the beginning of the big log period, and I was ferocious and... desperately in love, and so I ran up to Glasgow with my love, and we wobbled up and down Socky Hall Street, and then we lay down a lot. It was great.
How about the tour? You've been out for, as you say, a few weeks. Started off with some top secret dates around about Christmas time, and now you were in Newcastle last night. How's it going?
It was stunning. Last night was probably one of the best gigs I've done in my life, personally. I surprised myself as to what I was doing. I mean, material-wise, this show is very, very hard-driving, and it's very up, and it's real laugh, you know? It's a happy show. I think my meanders over the years, of course, have taken me, and not into extremes particularly, but just up little alleyways and cul-de-sacs, none of which I regret, but I must say that this current route and path that I'm taking is really exciting. And Newcastle City Hall is like... The crowd in Newcastle is like the Glasgow crowd. They really like to get a bit physical with the whole thing and enjoy themselves and actually really know that they've gone there and they come away exhausted. It's like a good relationship, you know? If you only have it once every 3 years, you've got to come out exhausted. Yeah. And so it was great. Well, I've been working now since about Christmas, and these top secret gigs, basically, they're called warm-ups, but every gig is a warm-up, you know. I mean, you can do the greatest gig in the world in the smallest, tiniest place. I mean, next month when I'm in America, I know that Meadowlands went on sale today, which is 22,000 seats, and they reckon it'll sell out today. The interest is, like, really wild, but it's... You can do a better gig at, say, Leicester University, just by chance, than you can do at Meadowlands. I mean, I'm not intimidated by the size of gigs and stuff, but you have to put the atmosphere across that makes the most sense, and it's the most hospitable atmosphere, because really you're welcoming an audience into your world, you know, into your personality. Mm-hmm. And my musical world has covered so many different areas, you know, from working with Alexis Corner through to Zeppelin and the Honey Drippers and all the different things that I've done. So it really is up to me to be a little, perhaps, lend an ear to people's desires a bit more than I have done. I mean, so many people have come and said, why do you keep doing this and that and the other? Why don't you just give us some songs we can all sing because we think you're all right? And I think, well, that's not what I'm here for. I'm here to please myself, you know. But I think this time, this show and this tour really is, it's a great compromise because everybody's coming away with that great grin, you know. Mm. And that's really a very wonderful possession to actually, or a wonderful quality to go to a concert and smile and yet really come out sweating, you know. Mm. It's a good one.
I'm sure this weekend there'll be plenty of people sweating at the Barrowland tomorrow night and the Playhouse through in Edinburgh on Sunday night. Right. However, I'm trying to work out how long it is since you played here in Scotland. Is it 5 or 6 years?
Let me see. 83. Well, it's 4.5 years because the tour was September, October, whatever it was. Then it was only the same two towns again. My plan is to come back in August from North America, and then in September, Phil's wife is having a baby, so he's panicking because, you know, he's got to stick around there and make sure everything's all right. So we'll then do more British dates, and we're going to play non-stop. I mean, the thing is that you can kind of fall foul of the rock and roll syndrome of working and then stopping and thinking about it and going off and falling in love over there and paying up over there, you know, and then beginning again 2 years later. And life goes by so quickly if you do that. That we decided that what our plan is to keep it all going, to keep on issuing singles over here, whether people like it or not, and to just make the whole thing really a continuous career rather than let's go and have a go at it and then retire into obscurity again. So really, I mean, we can play virtually indefinitely with the kind of enthusiasm that the band have got, both in their playing and in their approach to the thing. It's much easier to comprehend than anything I've done before, because even with Zeppelin, you know, as time went on, it was like, oh, I don't want to do this. Well, I want to do it. Well, I don't want to do it. Then you don't do it because somebody doesn't want to do it. But in this situation now, everybody's as keen can be, you know. And the guys haven't got the experience I've got, and they haven't experienced all the kind of wah that I've experienced. So they're really dying to get out there and stand up and be counted, you know. So, I mean, we can just keep going there.
Radio Clyde, of course, are recording the gig at the Barrowland tomorrow night. Does that put any extra pressure on both yourself being a bit more experienced and the new guys?
Not really. I mean, if it's a good night, it's a good night. vocally, I've been having a great time, so I don't think it matters. It doesn't matter.
We'll talk a bit about how you got the new guys into the band and of course about the new LP in a couple of minutes, but during the next couple of hours what we're going to do is have a couple of people on the phone who have written in with questions, so we'll speak to the first of those after we've heard the track that you released as a single. This is Heaven Knows, and that's from of course Now and Zen, the latest Robert Plant LP, which is doing rather well both here in the UK and over in the States. And Heaven Knows did rather well as a single. Robert, were you quite pleased at the success of that, especially in this country?
Well, some of my friends who've been around as long as me say, gosh, when Plant gets successful, he runs off in the corner and says, this can't be right. You know, I guess success is it depends on how you see success. I'm really proud that a record like like Heaven Knows could get so much airplay, because I think it's a quality song. I didn't write it, you know, but I mean, it's a beautiful song. And the very fact that it got that much attention was, you know, great, in amongst everything else. I mean, there's a lot of stuff I don't like. I get called bitchy for moaning about people, so I keep my mouth shut now. But it's nice to hear that sort of thing around it, and it's nice to hear Jimmy Page playing guitar on it and hearing that kind of aggressive guitar approach rather than the kind of stock-in-trade heavy metal guitar playing, which is like playing with gloves on. You know, a lot of the guitarists. So he and Page come in from that searing angle. The Prince of Darkness returns on vinyl, you know. It's great, I like it.
Is Heaven Knows the only track that you actually brought Jimmy in to work on?
No, the next single, which comes out in about 2 weeks, is Tall Cool One, and we've done a remix of that. We've done a dance version, which is very, very odd. In fact, if I see you tomorrow night, I'll try and bring the cassette and play it to you. Sounds like Climby Fisher Go to Hell. And he played on the new single, which is coming out, Tall Cool One, as well.
I know you've got him on towards the end of Tall Cool One, the sort of samples.
He's playing the lead break as well.
Yeah,
All in a day's work. Good old Jim.
Right, we're going over onto the phone lines now, Robert, if you like, and we'll talk to the first phone in, and it's Stephen. Hello, Stephen.
Hi, Tom.
Yeah, can you hear me okay?
Thanks.
Firstly, tell me, are you going to the gig tomorrow night?
Yeah, I am.
You are, right. You're through to Robert.
Hi, Robert.
Okay, fine. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. My question is, why is it just about impossible to get any Led Zeppelin video concert recordings, not including the song Remains the Same, at any record fairs or shops?
You mean stuff that was from other concerts?
Mm-hmm.
Well, basically, it's a kind of you can get a couple of things, but you have to get them on bootleg.
Yeah.
I know it's crazy me talking about bootlegs and stuff, but it doesn't matter because it's all a long time ago. Basically, the Nebworth was filmed with six cameras on both nights in 1979. Earl's Court was filmed in 1975, and a couple of other gigs were filmed. I think the first time we did the Albert Hall in 1970. Now, I've got film of Nebworth, and I've got film the other day, a bootleg from a girl in Newcastle of the Albert Hall, but nothing was ever actually mixed. Like with a record, you know, if you've got 24 tracks, you decide what you're going to use. But then nothing was ever mixed because somebody said, I don't like that, or, you know, I don't like this part of the thing or that part of the thing. So there was never ever a proper compilation done. I believe that Pagey's got access to loads of stuff, but I never ever talked to him about Led Zeppelin, so I never get round to asking him for copies of it. But I agree that it would be good now, especially with a lot of imitators around, to see what it was like then.
Yeah.
You know.
I just wondered if it had anything to do with Peter Grant.
Oh, no, no.
No?
No, I don't think so. I mean, he did have a lot of material, Peter. There was stuff that was done when we got a guy who used to do Top of the Pops or something to do in the early 70s. He filmed us. I think it was at the Bath Festival. But we went on late, and the lighting wasn't strong enough, so the whole film came out black. That was pretty clever, wasn't it? But it's a good idea, actually, to do that, because I must admit that the bootleg that I got the other day, even though the quality was poor, the actual and the musical quality was, you know, what we were playing. If you'd have got the original thing and done it properly, it would have been great.
Yeah.
I'll have a look into that. Thanks for reminding me.
Right, thanks a lot.
All right, mate. See ya. Take care.
So, Stephen, you're going to the gig tomorrow night. What about the LP? Have you bought Now and Zen yet?
No, not yet.
Why not?
I just haven't had the money yet.
Hey, well, listen, don't buy it. Just tape it off somebody else. I mean, the thing is that every dog has his day, and I had mine last night, so you don't have to buy it. But it's a good... I think it's the best thing that I've done for years. I've stopped copying out and excusing myself now from being that Robert Plant, you know? So if you haven't heard it, you'll hear quite a few songs from it tomorrow night.
Yeah.
And I hope you enjoy it.
All right, thanks very much.
All right, mate. Bye-bye.
Cheers.
Right, Stephen, thanks a lot for phoning in and speaking to us. And we'll have a couple of more phone-ins a wee bit later on in the programme. But firstly, let's go back to Robert and ask him about how the new Robert Plant band came about.
Well, the old Robert Plant band fell apart, basically. We did Wembley in 1985 after an American tour, after I'd done Live Aid and stuff when I was... Yeah, I mean, I was singing all right, but I was hoarse by the time I got to Live Aid. And it just come to the end of its tether. It had just finished and it exhausted itself, and it was a good run, but it wasn't really that spirited. So I set out checking out with all the different publishing companies to see what was around song-wise. And this song, Heaven Knows, and a couple of other ones by Johnston and Barrett hit the sort of mat and came through the letterbox and bonged onto the floor. And I heard this Heaven Knows, and I went, that's great. And I had a meeting with the guys, and I found out that they were Zeppelin freaks, but they were into hip-hop and all sorts of kind of very aggressive music, you know? Everything from Smiley Culture through to Hendrix, if you like. But they were young, aggressive guys, and it was great to be confronted with people who weren't either patting you on the back or calling you an old fart, but there you were, with modern musicians who were actually really ambitious. And Phil Johnston, as a keyboard player and a guitarist and a singer, is really a very, very smart cookie. And so I started writing with him and his partner Dave Barrett. We wrote White, Clean and Neat, Tall, Cool One, and about two or three other things in about 3 days. The relationship was so vibrant. And he then introduced me to Chris Blackwell, the drummer, who is nothing short of stunning. And Chris knew Doug Boyle, and Doug brought along Phil Scragg. Now, Phil Scragg, the bass player, didn't come on the road with us, so we got this guy called Charlie Jones, who was in a group called Violent Blue. So, I mean, everybody's really untried in the big rock and roll syndrome. Mm-hmm. And for that, it's great because their personalities, they're developing their personalities day by day. You know, that you know you have a way of dealing with the radio. You either go into the microphone like this and you talk like that, or you go over here and you know exactly what you're doing. But this band and the way that it is now delivering is actually developing by the day. It's a remarkable time to be around. I mean, the crew are fantastic because everybody knows that this thing is just growing all the time. It's almost like I never did anything before, you know, because the enthusiasm is so remarkable. And it doesn't have any of that kind of jaded cynicism, all that piss-taking and all that kind of... how much are we getting for this, and what's that over there, and I want that woman in the third row. I'm the only one who says that.
It's probably a lot sort of memories of 1968 for you.
No, 1968, I was nervous as hell. I was petrified. I mean, I was really green.
As the rest of the boys are, you've just been saying.
Sure, yeah, but I mean, I think that with the people around who've got the experience, I mean, I've got a great manager now who looks after Townsend and Judas Priest and people like that, and he's really, he directed Quadrophenia and stuff, and he's really happening. And everybody's making it gentle for him, you know? There's no aggression around at all. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't quite the way in 1968. 68 was a very changing time. You know,
when you say aggression, are you talking about within the band or out with?
Yeah, I think there were in Zeppelin. A lot of people did me a lot of favours, but a lot of people also got on my case a lot. You know, a lot of the kind of people on the outside who were spiralling around the Zeppelin world could have been a little kinder on reflection. And in this situation, I've learnt all the naff bad bits in my career about dealing with people, and I know now exactly what to do, kind of what to do and what not to do, you know. Mm-hmm. So the band really are cushioned from anything that's unpleasant, but they're incredible. I mean, they go and they work and work and work and rock like mad, and I'm in the middle of them all looking at them as if I've known them for 100 years, you know.
Are you struggling to keep up?
No, come on. Hey, listen, I was born doing this.
Right, we better take a break and have a listen to another track from the new LP, so we'll do that now. And that's from, of course, Now and Zen, our guest on The Rock Show tonight, the full 2 hours of The Rock Show, devoted to one man, Mr. Robert Plant. Robert, Tall Cool One, I think you said, is going to be the next single, didn't you?
Mm-hmm, yeah. We've done several different mixes of it. We've made it more aggressive than the album track. We've done a kind of, as I said earlier, on a kind of Climby Fisher dance mix, which is really quite peculiar. Mm-hmm. Still with a guitar solo, and that just changing the key the time signature. So there's lots of different interesting ways of presenting the thing, and it's still a veritable volcano, whichever way you do it, you know, musically. I mean, it's a real storming track.
Yeah, it's a good one.
Mm.
Let's go back a couple of years and talk about your third solo LP, which came out, Shaken and Stirred. At the time, you were quoted in all the press as raving about it. It was your favourite piece of plastic so far. Mm-hmm. But it didn't get accepted. It didn't sell terribly well. Maybe half a million or a million, I don't know. But it certainly didn't sell as well. How disappointed were you, on reflection, that it wasn't accepted?
Well, you're right. I mean, this record now has doubled, sold twice as many as Shaken and Stirred already, you know. But that sales are neither here nor there. Otherwise, I should be playing the Scottish Exhibition Centre, you know.
No, I don't mean so much sales. How disappointed you were that it didn't sell. How disappointed were you that it wasn't accepted?
Yeah. Well, it was heartbreaking, really, because I figured that there was so much stuff around that I didn't really like. There were so many people pretending to be rock gods, and all this kind of hard, tough rock, which was, a lot of it was really pretense, like pantomime, you know? And really, and I thought, well, this is how you do it. You have to keep on moving the music along. You can't keep on aping out the same old stuff. Everybody can't be Gene Simmons from Kiss forever, with or without the makeup. You've got to come up with something a little more interesting and a little more musically challenging for yourself, you know. it's for yourself, baby, really, you know. I mean, in the end, if you have success, that's neither here nor there. But it wasn't accepted. It didn't go to radio. Radio didn't play it. And it wasn't an easily listenable record to begin with. I mean, a lot of people who've got it now have said to me that it took a long time and they're really glad that this current record is much more acceptable. It's much more accessible. You can sing with it, you know. You can actually hum along with it if you want to. But I just figured that it was nice, and I do respect people who've actually gone out and left something that's nice and safe musically and gone off and had a bash and they've pleased themselves. Now, people like Bill Nelson from Bebop Deluxe makes great records. I like his music, you know. Commercial success doesn't follow because there's no radio to play it, you know, because it is right on the fringe. And Peter Gabriel didn't come in from the cold for quite a while after Genesis. When he left Genesis, I think he did everything for the right reason. I think he saw it. I know how he felt about it because I know him. In fact, I got his sound guy working for me now. And also the guy who brought me here is Phil Collins' man too, you know. So, I mean, I know exactly the workings of all these things. I know that Phil did what he wanted to do, whether he sold records or not. It's just the acceptance. When you've been the singer from Led Zeppelin and you've done so many things and had so much kind of acclaim, then the legend accelerates and it kind of rolls along in front of you, rather like some kind of tidal wave which you don't even control from behind. You're just there with it, you know? You get sucked along. So now the reality of it is, if you make a good record and it's played on the radio and it's acceptable and people like it, it's a success because there's no breaks from the legend anymore. And I did feel a little gutted. I did think that I'd made some reasonable musical statement, but I think little by little got six plays on national radio, and I don't know how you got on with it up here, but it wasn't a pop orientated record. And I guess it would be nice if there were a few more records around that weren't just instantly trying to go for your ears, you know. Just get into the music, enjoy it. Zeppelin was always changing. It just happened to do it a bit better than I do it.
Of course, in the 68, or should I say the 70s, with Zeppelin, singles, you didn't release singles. Radio play, you didn't court. You got some, but it wasn't necessary. Do you think the market has changed so much now that without radio play and without the hit single, you're just on a loser?
Well, radio has changed dramatically, and people's places within the radio structure, like, say, Pink Floyd and people like that, you find if you look in their album charts that a rock record without a hit single in Britain will go into the charts for the first week or two, it'll hold, and then it'll disappear completely because there is no sales. Because somebody in, say, Selkirk, where I was at lunchtime, he's not going to hear about it or even know about it, you know? So the momentum has changed now. And however, in the 1970s, there wasn't a great deal of radio play either, as you say. But the awareness of the people then was much greater and much more tuned into album-type bands, you know? So Rory Gallagher would do well. Emerson, Lake and Palmer, Pink Floyd, Led Zeppelin, the loads of bands who didn't even need Radio 1 because Melody Maker every week was, you know, flogging you to death. You couldn't avoid it. And every radio station did have its rock programs too, so you did have once or twice a week the facility. But, I mean, there was not a month would go by if we were working that we wouldn't be on the cover of one of the magazines, you know. But now the whole big band thing is considered to be almost, I don't know, it's not happening anymore as far as the magazines are concerned. So you get Wet, 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 or you get the guy from Prefab Sprout, or Jesus and Mary Chain, or whatever it is. But you won't see Dave, what's his name, Gilmore, or...
That scene's moved on to Kerrang and Metal Hammer, though, hasn't it?
Well, I don't think Dave Gilmore should be in Kerrang either. Slimmers Weekly would be a good idea. But, you know, the whole kind of the vision of tough music in Kerrang and Metal Hammer is, well, you know, it's like, it's a pastiche. It's like, hey, that was Zeppelin and that was that. Now, have a bit of this. This is a combination. This week's model is a combination of a bit of Led Zeppelin, son of Thin Lizzy, and let's see, we'll have just a touch of Mick Jagger there, and there you have the next group. Mm. It's like a spoonful of this and two spoons of that. But the old, in the old days, I guess, or in those days, that the kind of awareness thing was much greater, you know? But, I mean, people like Whitesnake do okay. They sell singles, which are virtually, they're just pop singles.
Mm. Even when Robert Plant slags them off.
Absolutely, that's what I'm here for. You ask David when you see him again. He'll have some incredible blue or black eyes when I catch him.
Why?
Because he's an old tart. Because he's an old friend of mine, and he's too old to copy people. He should be doing in what he does by himself with his own style, I think.
Mm. What are you talking about, the latest LP?
I'm talking about that Led Zeppelin single that broke the album in America. I mean, I'm not bitching. I just think that when you know, you're in the same, coming out the same egg, you know, you keep your individuality. When you talk about Kingdom Come, they're kids, you know, 21 years old or whatever it is. So it's quite acceptable. If I did Chuck Berry songs or Carl Perkins songs or whatever it is, they're both still alive. It's acceptable to mimic somebody from the previous generation, but not to have somebody of the same generation doing the same old crap again, you know, just to get a hit or whatever it takes. So it's kind of, I mean, I don't mind, but I just think that morally, you should actually just take it on a bit farther. If you're going to do a Zeppelin copy or whatever, or a Pink Floyd copy or whatever, you should actually extend it just that bit more. Take it maybe where Zeppelin should have taken it in the end.
Like the Far Corporation.
Good Lord. Oh, dear, oh, dear. I think I'd rather have a... No, I don't know.
Well, funnily enough, though, in the last 2-3 years, the fashion, as far as Led Zeppelin, in brackets, is concerned, the latter days of Zeppelin and the first 2 or 3 years of your solo career, press, everything, Zeppelin were the dinosaurs that should be shot down. And suddenly, just about 2 years ago, it changed, and suddenly it became fashionable to admit in the Melody Maker or the NME some of these young up-and-coming bands who would never have been seen dead with a Zeppelin album under under their arm. Suddenly they started admitting, well, I actually quite liked Led Zeppelin. And then it progressed to they were bringing out tracks on their LPs that sounded like Led Zeppelin. And, well, we've reached now the Kingdom Come. Mm. So can I ask you about we've dealt with the Whitesnake situation. Can I ask you about the cult, the mission?
Well, yeah, you know, the thing with the Southern Death Cult were a punk band. And then they became the Death Cult, and then they became the Cult. And you know that punk, some of the best parts of punk were things like New Rose or Fan Club, that kind of damned stuff, you know, which were great riffs. And really had all power and energy that Communication Breakdown had, or from Led Zeppelin 1, or Wearing and Tearing from Coda, the last Led Zeppelin album. And it was the energy that was in all that was really good, and the riffs on the punk stuff. So basically, the punk and Led Zeppelin stuff was not that far removed. I don't think with Black Sabbath or whatever it was quite so easy to borrow it, because their riffs were longer, more drawn out, and not so, quite so exciting. I mean, Page is the king of riff makers, you know, without a doubt. So really, all those kind of Zeppelin riffs, the power of not the thrash, not the Anthrax element of it, but the actual Led Zeppelin power and glory, suddenly became like, God, that's nice, after all that kind of amateur music time. Listen to that, listen to Kashmir or In the Light, and you hear that it's not heavy metal, and it's kind of a weird corner of hard rock, if you like. So when I meet the Cult now, and I know them, you know, and I stormed into the dressing room with the Mission the other day. I had such a laugh with them, saying to them, what do you mean by nicking Kashmir twice on one album and then on another and then getting John Paul Jones to play on it? Come on.
Did you have your twinkle in your eye at the time?
Oh, of course I did, yeah. So the drummer offered me a tab of acid and said he was sorry. But, you know, this whole Zeppelin thing is very flattering, especially to Jimmy, I think, because when I got together with him a couple of years ago, he said to me, listen, man, all I know, really, is just some old riffs. And all those old riffs are everywhere. They're on every beatbox album you can get. You know, they're all over a lot of those records. You know, that first Whitesnake single is a cross between Black Dog and Whole Lot of Love. And it's not even making any apology for it, you know. So it's kind of flattering. And with the Mission being more of a kind of goth, mellow side of Zeppelin, I don't think there's any reason to knock anybody. I mean, I've always twinkled my eye. That's where people get it wrong, because they don't. It's very hard to see you twinkling your eye on the radio, you know. But it's very,
I can assure listeners at this very moment, Robert has got a twinkle in his eye.
And also, I really do like what the Mission and the Cult happen to be doing. I think maybe when they've done it a bit longer, and they develop even more individuality and themselves, you know, then it'll be really good. Right now, I mean, I played with loads of bands in America in the 70s, like the James Gang and people like that, you know, and they were all tough bands. And these bands remind me of that kind of genre of group where there's a lot of them about, and it's just another one of those bands, you know.
We'll better take another break at this stage, Robert, if you don't mind, and we'll come back and we're going to play a couple of bits of music, not all the way through. I'm going to play a bit of music from Kingdom Come, just a little bit, and a bit of music from another band, and they're called Stone Fury, after this break.
I'm Russell, Radio Clyde, nothing's wild.
And welcome back to the Rock Show with me, Tom Russell. Rather special rock show this evening, because we have a special live guest with us. His name is, of course, Robert Plant. We've been playing some music from his new album, and we're going to be playing some more music from that album, as well as some tracks from Zeppelin. But obviously requests and things this week, we're going to leave out, put them forward to next week. But just like to go through the gig guide quickly with you for this next few days. Tomorrow night, of course, Saturday night, 26th, Robert Plant and It Bites, excellent support band, tomorrow night at the Barrowland. Centurion are playing at Harlequins in Airdrie, and Stormbringer are playing Reflections in Irvine in the afternoon, with the Top Inn in Cumnock in the evening. Saturday night, the 27th, Robert Plant and It Bites moves on to the Playhouse, with Comedy of Errors playing the Glenfinnan in Falkirk. Next Tuesday, that's Tuesday the 29th, Chariot come up from London to play the Venue here in Glasgow, Sockhill Street. That's Tuesday night. And Wednesday night, the 30th, Chariot play the Bruce Hotel in East Kilbride, with Magnum and Kingdom Come playing the Barrowland here in Glasgow. Thursday night, 31st, Glasgow and Trident play Kirkintilloch Town Hall. Friday night, the 1st, and Saturday, the 2nd of April, that's next Friday and Saturday, Alice Cooper at the Playhouse. And Friday night, the 1st, Glasgow play the Venue. That's the gig guide for the moment. As I said, Robert Plant is our special guest tonight, so we're not giving out requests and things tonight. It's slightly different. Just before the news there, we played a couple of pieces of music for you. We played a track from the band who are going to be supporting Magnum on Wednesday. They're called Kingdom Come, and that's from a new LP just out in Polydor, which is titled Kingdom Come, and it sounds, I'm sure you'll agree, remarkably like Led Zeppelin. And just after that, we played a track from a band called Stone Fury. Now, that was recorded about 4 or 5 years ago, and it was called Break Down the Walls, and the singer was Stone Fury, the same guy that sings with Kingdom Come. What do you think, Robert? I mean, Stone Fury, it was nothing like Led Zeppelin, was it?
No, of course it's not. Well, you know, the thing is, I know the guy, it's terrible, isn't it? I knew the bride when she used to rock and roll. I knew the guy, I know the guy who's just signed Jimmy Page to Geffen Records. He also signed Whitesnake, and he was saying about the hole in the market. Now, this is terrible to be talking, and to be saying that there's a hole in the record market where people want Led Zeppelin. You know, they do.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can fill it, then you suddenly, I mean, you sell a lot of records. And these guys are businessmen, and they just say, OK, if you can do that, that's great. And some people actually go out as a career move to latch onto things that sound like sounding like. There were a million Doors impersonators, and there were a million Beatle impersonators.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I even collect records by Presley impersonators. Really obscure stuff, you know? So I guess it's like, yeah, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I'm bound to meet the guy, because I believe that they're on tour right now with Magnum.
Mm. Yeah, they're playing here in Glasgow on Wednesday.
Well, the bed'll still be warm where I slept, Mr. Wolf, so you better be good.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it, listening to the Kingdom Come track there, which is just Led Zeppelin. I mean, it's there's no getting away from it. And then listening to what the guy was doing 2-3 years ago.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I think I rather prefer him sounding like Led Zeppelin than sounding like the other way, you know, because that sort of chugging guitar, there's a million bands doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, it's kind of odd, because when I first heard it, I mean, the more I talk about it, the more importance I give him, right? But, when I first heard it, I got chills up my back. And I went, God, but I sing like that at rehearsals now. I just, you know, and all that phasing on the voice and stuff. In fact, now in my set, I'm phasing the voice. I'm learning how to do me from them. Because I'd forgotten about all those little tricks. Or not bothered about them, to be perfectly frank.
Mm.
But all's fair in love, rock and roll and music, I suppose.
Making a living, yeah.
I don't think it's right that people have to make a living by actually going out and virtually impersonating. I mean, there's a band called The White in America. There's a lot of bands who actually do Led Zeppelin revival shows. They sell 7,000 tickets a night.
Mm.
The guy, Michael White, was signed by Atlantic. And he even looks like me, except for he's carrying a bit of weight around his belly. He's probably been on the 80 shilling. But I think it's a bit odd, really, just going out there and being part of here. If you like this emotionally, have a bit of this. It's almost the same, but not quite.
Mm-hmm. You get the Presley imitators over here, don't you?
Yeah.
Doing their old shows. Right, what we're going to do now. Last week we were on a competition, Robert, with 5 pairs of tickets for tomorrow night's Barrowland gig, and with a couple of albums that you autographed. I wonder if you'd mind reading out the winners.
It's a sign I'm almost part of the establishment. Here I am now. It's like family favourites. Okay, well, the tickets for Barrowlands. 2 tickets go to Miss Helena Murray, 70 Wood Quad, White Crook, Clydebank, just around the corner. And tickets also go to Robert Glover, 34 Morven Avenue, Potter Hill, Paisley. I know, the hills of Morven in North Argyll. Also, Billy Fletcher, a 14 Creden Drive, Crosshouse, Kilmarnock. He also wanted to know if I'm playing at the Atlantic birthday celebrations at Madison Square Garden in May. Yes, I am. Without him. And also the tickets, Davy Muirhead of 119 Stratford, Calderwood, East Kilbride. And tickets to Stephen Crawford, 136 Sterling Drive, Linwood, Renfrewshire. Now, LP winners. Robert Glover, 34 Morven Avenue. He's done it again. You're doing very well. Perhaps you only had 5 cards altogether.
Just been lucky.
Yeah, 34 Morven Avenue, Potter Hill. That's kind of odd. And also Grant Jameson, 34 Newton Crescent, Dunbury, Perthshire.
Dundee.
Nah, can't be. The B's the wrong way around. Anyway, who knows?
Oh, it's Dunblane.
Dunblane, that'll do. Okay, that's great. Well done. Well, I hope you enjoy the gig tomorrow night. I know I will, because I'm really having the time of my life. And I hope you enjoy the records, you people who got them.
Great, thanks, Robert. What we'll do now is we'll cross over to the phone lines again if we've got things organised, and we'll speak to Fiona Jane McLaren, who's on the line from King's Park in Glasgow. Fiona Jane, can you hear us okay?
Yes, I can.
Hi, have you been listening, have you?
Yeah.
You're through right now to Robert Plant.
Okay.
Hello, Fiona.
Hi, Robert.
Hi.
My question is, what's the most embarrassing moment of your life?
The most embarrassing moment was, let me see, that's a very difficult question. My life as opposed to my career. I do remember singing the usual one about my trousers splitting when I'm singing. It's crazy, but it does happen. I think the most uncomfortable and embarrassing moment was when I played at Live Aid 2 years ago in America. And there was all the kind of fuss about Led Zeppelin reforming and to the concert. And I walked out onto the stage to an incredible, well, we all walked out, to an incredible ovation from everybody. And I opened my mouth and I couldn't sing. I was hoarse. And I looked at my companions around me and I went, I couldn't even gesture to my throat and say, you know, this is it. I just had to stand there. And I realised that I remember John Bonham used to say to me years ago, listen, Planty, you can't sing. Just go out there and look good. So, basically, that was a terrible moment. It's not often that 1.5 billion people get to watch you and you blow it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
No.
Okay?
Yeah, will Jimmy Page be at the concert?
No, I don't think so. I think Jimmy's rehearsing with his band. He's going to go to America shortly after I am. And he's got a new singer who's real cute. And he's not... he's all right, actually. And he's got Jason Bonham playing drums with him. And he won't be coming to Glasgow, no. We can live. We'd be all right without him. Fiona, don't worry.
Are you going to the show, Fiona?
Yeah. It's an 18. I hope I get in.
I hope you get in, too.
Because I bought the tickets and I never knew it was an 18.
What age are you, Fiona?
15.
Yeah, yeah, you can bluff, can't you? When I went to America, they wouldn't let me in the bars because I was too young to drink. You'd be all right.
I don't want to drink, I just want to get in.
Yeah. Okay, well, you'll be all right. I don't think... I'm sure you don't look that much younger than 18, do you?
No.
Good.
Have you been to many concerts, Fiona Jean?
I've only been to one last month. December, it's a Tupou one.
Well, if you enjoyed Tupou, I think you should make sure you're along in time for the support tomorrow night because it's a first-class band. Yeah. They called it Bites.
Oh, yeah, I've heard them.
Yeah, they're very good. And they're great guys, too. They're good northern lads. And they really are... it's a good musical combination between what my band does, which is quite tough rock and roll, and what they do, which is pretty musical. They're good lads. Well, listen, I'll see you there. I hope I do.
Right.
Ship of Fools, beautiful song from the Now and Zen LP, written by Robert Plant. Robert, can we go through the LP just briefly and talk about each song? We've talked about Heaven Knows, the single, not written by yourself. One wee question on that. What was the Tom Tom Macoute? Was it an African gang or something?
No. It was the secret police that Papa Doc used down in Haiti. Everything that he wanted, anything that he wanted to be done was done by the Tom Tom Macoute.
I was thinking about the Belgian Congo. It's obviously the same sort of idea.
Yeah, there was a guy called Johnny Jenkins did an album called Tom Tom Macoute in the early 70s. So, yeah, with all the romance of the Tom Tom Macoute.
Yeah, that's
nice, eh?
Beautiful line. Second track on the LP, Dance on My Own. Just if you listen really closely at the beginning, you hear a wee bit of whistling, and it sounds a bit like the news, the BBC News or something.
It's the World Service.
Yeah.
It goes... It's the beginning of, this is England, or this is London. Yeah. Bong, bong. It's
like, what's that doing at the start of the song?
Well, I was whistling it, because wherever I go, I take shortwave radio, and I always want to know what's going on. I called the song originally Radio Shape because I figured it was quite a Radio Shape song, you know. If I wasn't going to get Little by Little played, I'll get this... I was going to swear that I'll get this one played. So that was the Radio Shape part, was the actual... You know, it should really have been perhaps... it's 5 o'clock, it's Saturday, it's Radio 2, and it's over to James Alexander Gordon at the... You know, it's like one of those sort of things. Yeah, it's a good song. It's a sleazy song. It's got a lot of sex. A lot of sex, a lot of sleaze. It's kind of... there are places that you can go around the world. I don't know how many there are here, but I'm looking for them. Sleazy clubs with a lot of kind of... hoochie-coochie kind of moving around. A lot of real nice tiger women, you know, that sort of thing.
Is there any of those in Glasgow?
I don't know. I'll let you know tomorrow. I'm going to find out in about half an hour. But, in New York especially, not especially, but there's a big Puerto Rican population in Spanish Harlem. And the clubs up there, the people are incredible. They're so pretty. And the men and the women are great because they've dressed real good. They look real sharp. And they real take a lot of care of themselves. And they really do enjoy themselves. It's a very sexy night, you know. You sit there and you suddenly feel such a turkey being British because we're so kind of... Maybe if we dance around our handbags, we're doing fine, or if we bang our heads. But these people have got some great movements, you know. Mm. And I've yet to feel the full benefit of them. But really, it was like that was what it was. Radio Shape was that kind of if you listen to the drums on it and stuff, it's like real sleaze.
Mm-hmm. Next one's Tall Cool One, which we played earlier, of course. One question about why did you decide to use the old bits of Zeppelin at the end, the samples?
Because it's my turn, basically.
Simple as that.
Mm. I like them, and I've tuned them up a bit and messed around with them, and yeah, I like them.
Mm-hmm. Another question just before we go into the next track, The Way I Feel. Lyric sheets, your three previous solo LP, you didn't include lyric sheets. This one you have done, mm-hmm. but only half the songs. Why?
Because only half of them are worth reading the lyrics to, basically. It's very straightforward stuff, this, yeah. Yeah, I think they're the best. Lyrically, they're much more interesting than the others, perhaps. And I don't like I Love You Baby la-di-da-di-da, you know? Or Squeeze My Lemon Till the Juice Runs Down My Leg. I mean, these things, are they don't need any explanation. But I think those tracks, especially White, Clean and Neat, I mean... And The Way I Feel is Big Log Part 2. It is a continuation of Big Log. It's not a ballad, you know? But it's lyrically, it's what happened all that time later. 5 years on from Big Log.
I'm back behind the wheel, nervous.
Yeah, just a little nervous. It's something to do with the way I feel. You know? Yeah, see what I'm driving at, and I'm back inside the car. Travel in luxury, a little celebration when I've touched too far. There's been this trouble in the world of love, you know?
Well, then flip over to the classic Helen of Troy.
She walks like a gunslinger, shoots lead from the hips. Yeah.
Must be about someone in particular.
Yeah, great big fat diving instructress I saw, who I was learning to, wanted to scuba dive. Since I packed up smoking cigarettes, you know...
Was this on the Isle of Arran?
No.
You were scuba diving?
No. This is in the canal in the West Midlands. And she kind of had a way about her where, like, no man would mess with this woman, you know. She had the whole world... exactly the way she wanted everything, you know, you could tell. And not only that, she had a kind of one of those diver's knives attached to her leg in a kind of you know, one of those knife pouches. And I thought, God, that woman has got a world of her own. She's Helen of Troy, you know, the world is waiting there for you. And that was what it was.
That's another good song. After that we have the rockabilly one. Billy's Revenge.
Billy's Revenge is, to me, is a little bit of a triumph, because if I don't do any more Honey Dripper stuff, which I probably shan't, then that's probably what I was getting to, that kind of psychobilly stuff, which, little story. It's really like a Harry Dean Stanton B-movie, you know? These two people are... Billy and Ginny will never get old. That's the kind of love that leaves a story untold, you know? It's like there's all sorts of trouble going on there. But it's, it's just a swipe at rockabilly, but it's tough stuff, I think.
One of my favourite all-time pieces of music from Robert Plant, not the favourite, but one of my all-time favourites, is Rockin' at Midnight.
Great song.
I think it's brilliant, and I think it was a sin that they flipped it and made that the B-side. Was it Sea of Love was the hit? Rockin' at Midnight was just so much better, in my opinion.
I think it's a great song, but unfortunately... in America, I mean, we took it off the B-side in America and put I Get a Thrill on, because they did turn it over. I wanted Rockin' at Midnight to be on the radio. But they turned it over, they played the other side. It was a big, big hit at Sea of Love. So I whipped Rockin' at Midnight off and stuck it out as a second single in America, and it got in the top 20 singles. And it was great to hear that alongside Heart... and, you know, all that sort of an REO Speedwagon, and then suddenly you'd hear ba ba da 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 da. It was kind of a nice little thing to do. But never again, not for a while.
I love it. I still play it when I'm doing the rock discos, and the place goes mad.
It's great to bop to and jive. I mean, if you liked a bit of jive, it's really good.
Anyway, after Billy's Revenge, the rockabilly one, we go on to the track we played a few minutes ago, Ship of Fools. Again, I love the lyrics now. On waves of love, my heart is breaking. I am the pilot of the storm. Is that a personal song?
Well, it sounds very much like it, yeah, but, I mean, it's... How can I say it? I don't know, really. I mean, if you go back to things like the Rain Song in Zeppelin, you know, then that was much more personal. This Ship of Fools is, I'm trying to kind of capture how I felt at different points in time. And I'm not very, very, very good at doing it, but I've got a good combination of cause and effect here now. I've been around a long time. I've fallen in and out of love, you know, rather like a cuckoo getting in and out of a nest, you know, all the time. And so my sensitivities fluctuate a lot, you know. It's a great feeling to be in love, and it's a kind of odd feeling to be out of love. And that's happened to me several times. It's happened to everybody else, you know. But it, so I write things down as I'm chugging along. And I think that the song began because I remember somebody saying, you know, no man is an island. And you claim that no man is an island is the first words of the last verse. It's a nice song. It's a bit pretty, you know. I'm not in a kind of pretty mood right now musically. It's much more sort of 1, 2, 3, 4, go.
Mm.
But it's a nice song, and Doug plays stunning guitar.
How's he getting on, incidentally, on the tour? I read a quote somewhere that before he joined you, he hadn't played to any more than 200 people. So how's he doing playing in front of thousands?
Well, he's doing great. I mean, he's a born performer. He's, what, 24 years old? So he's been around playing for a while, and he's now getting a great response from people, which is something that he played a lot like in the kind of mold of Alan Holdsworth before. But now he's been listening to Buddy Guy and Otis Rush and Brian Setzer to a degree, you know, all that kind of Gene Vincent rockabilly stuff. He's learned a lot about the blues, which is an area that he thought was just, oh, well, the blues was the blues, you know, but leave it alone. But when you start listening to T-Bone Walker or a lot of these blues guys, their playing is so good, and it's so random. The great thing about Jimmy and Jeff Beck is that they fly at the instrument. They don't just play it politely and say, this fills the spot for the guitar solo. They just come in from another planet. When I saw Jimmy with Paul Rodgers in The Firm, I was so proud of him, Paige, because he flew into solos. He just came. There's no politeness. It was dangerous stuff, you know.
Mm.
And Doug's now dangerous. He's doing great.
How about... you're talking there about the blues. There's no blues songs on the new LP.
No, there is.
Really?
Yeah. The last track on side two is a blues. It doesn't sound like a blues on first listening to it.
Why?
Why? Because it's white, clean and neat. Because it's the story of what it was like to be brought up in a kind of working class home and have all the kind of sensitivity of what was going on in the world shielded from you. You didn't know what was going on. And nobody wanted you to know that there. It was a big, mean old world with a lot of things going on, a lot of teenage rebellion, a lot of changes that were kept from me, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And all the time, they were kept from a lot of other people. You know, the whole of the kind of rock and roll rebellion was the most dramatic rebellion ever, I think, culturally, brought on with a flag-waving troupe of real loony rockabilly singers, rock and roll singers, you know? And I don't think for everybody from the mayors of these towns in America to the disc jockeys who used to smash the records up on the, you know, you see film and footage of the disc jockey saying, that's the last Elvis Presley record I'll ever play, smash. You know, meanwhile, I was a kid just growing up there, a little baby boy, and nobody ever let me know about all this. And the social implications. Everybody was bored with the crooners. Just like a lot of people got bored with Pink Floyd and Black Sabbath, you know.
And your mum and dad were listening to Johnny Ray and Pat Boone and...
Well, I think Johnny Ray actually was pretty hot. I think he was quite, you know, I think he had a lot of slink about him, and I hope he still does.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, the Pat Boone thing, that white, laundered rock and roll stuff was awful. Terrible. Mm-hmm. And that was what it was supposed to be all about.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, lurking in the background were all the Wild Boys, you know. And... when you get exposed to that kind of thing, you go, God, this is great. I feel free. I feel my identity. I can latch on to this, you know? And that's what White, Clean and Neat's all about. So it's a blues for living at home.
And welcome back to The Rock Show with me, Tom Russell. Our special guest on the programme tonight is Robert Plant. We've got another phone line open just now, and we're going over to Motherwell. I'm going to talk to a guy who's actually a singer. He sings with one of the better Scottish bands. They haven't signed a recording deal yet, but they're a good band. They're called La Paz, and the singer's name is Doogie. Doogie, hello there.
Hello, Tom.
You've been listening quite happily there, and mother will have you. You're through to Robert Plant.
Hi, Doogie.
Robert.
How you doing?
It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you.
This is a bit of a selfish question. I was just wondering what kind of preparation you do on your vocals for a world tour. I know, for instance, that Phil Collins has a sauna or a Turkish every day to keep his vocal cords moist.
Phil Collins has a sauna?
My friend Coverdale has 3 days on and 1 day off. So what advice would you give to myself and other singers that they get the best results and the best performances possible?
Mm. Well, you know, I don't know about you, but do you smoke?
I do smoke.
Yeah, well, I smoked for 20-odd years, and I just... Last July, when I was doing this album, I just thought, right, I've got to stop this. Because I was producing the thing with the other guys and smoking all day and getting het up and then starting to sing and found that my voice was knackered. So, first of all, I stopped smoking. But the rest of the time, I don't think there's a great deal of preparation that you can do, but steam is really pretty good. And on this tour, I'm just doing 2 days on, 1 day off, 2 days on, 1 day off, just to see and try and harden my voice, you know?
Uh-huh.
But I found that 3 days ago, my throat was killing me because I'd been giving it such a thrashing. At rehearsals a week last Sunday, I did the Friday, Saturday and Sunday, probably about 4 hours each day, going through songs, and we were actually fitting in a new encore, Howlin' Wolf thing. And I found it was really difficult to... I couldn't even speak on the Sunday, so by the time I got to this week, my voice had never really got over it, so I was doing gigs and my voice hadn't really come back. So I started saltwater gargling.
Uh-huh.
And I just did that a couple of times in the day and kept my mouth shut for a while. And, but it's all paranoia, it's all in the mind, you know? I mean, I used to think that, Christ, I can't do this and I can't do that. So I stopped smoking dope, I stopped smoking cigarettes, I never drink on the day of a gig, only in the evening afterwards, which is probably just as bad. But I think if you harden your vocal cords, if you take it steady and you just build them up so as they can take a thrashing, you know?
Aye. Well, it was just that I've always thought that you've got to treat it a bit like an athlete treats his body.
Yeah.
You know, you've got to have a sort of warm-up, you've got to treat it like that all the time. You know, but we have a special drink up here in Scotland that we take before we do live vocal performances.
What's that?
Dark rum, green ginger,
mm-hmm.
heated in the microwave with a touch of honey.
Golly.
You can coast through it, no problem.
Yeah? I'll let you try that.
No problem.
How about don't you get a bit cross-eyed and cross-legged there in the middle?
Well, that's the problem. It moves you out in the floor, you know, but... You sing pretty well.
Yeah, but you're always lying down when you're doing it.
Exactly.
Mind you, some of my better performances have been like that, I have to tell you. but I don't know, really. You know, the thing is that with Phil Collins, in fact, the chap who's sitting in the room with me now has worked with Phil for years, and he's just left him because the money wasn't very good. And and we were talking about Phil's voice, and it was... if you get... nervous about it, it just makes it worse and worse and worse.
I find that myself.
Mm.
You know, it's a sort of, it is a mental thing, like you say.
Mm.
You know, if you're relaxed enough, you can deal with it.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, the way I've gone into this tour now is, I kind of almost destroyed most of my following, if you like. So I've got very little else to lose now. So I might as well just have a great time. And I'm singing so much better than I've sung for years, and doing Zeppelin songs too. It's like doing Misty Mountain Hop. It's like, sometimes I think, shall I go for that real high one? And I think, it's right at the end of the show. No, bugger it, leave it, because otherwise you'll never be able to sing tomorrow. But then again, I go for them. And I guess it's just like, really, I don't care. If I get to a gig and I can't sing, well, I can't sing. It's too bad. But I've never ever thought like that before. I've always been really neurotic about it. But now, it's, you know, if you're lucky, it's great. And I've been singing a lot better, so I think... It's partly confidence and partly knocking fags on the head and partly keeping some steam and maybe saltwater gargles and making sure there's a few nice girls at the front.
Well, that always helps. Right, so if you're in Wishaw tomorrow, if you're in Wishaw tomorrow in Girwood's Bar in the afternoon, I know you're looking for a drink somewhere in the afternoon.
Yeah.
I'll buy you that rum and green ginger.
What's that called? Gerwood's?
Gerwood's in Wishaw. You get off at the station, you come out, and it's just 50 yards. Mm. I'll buy you that rum and green ginger, and I'll bring up the honey.
Okay, and I'll probably bring up last night's tea. Okay, I'll see you there. See you, Dougie.
Until then, I'll see you on Sunday.
Okay, great.
Right, thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.
Dougie, you're not going to the Barrowlands tomorrow night?
Well, I actually booked my tickets for the Playhouse before the Barrowlands was announced.
Of course, the Playhouse gig was announced for two or three weeks before.
I was on the telephone and it was engaged constantly, mm-hmm. and I managed to get through on the second day.
Mm-hmm. Have you got the album yet, Dougie?
I haven't got the album. My gyro comes in tomorrow, and that'll be the first thing I'll do. Just go down and buy the album tomorrow.
Mm. Well, I'll get somebody to tape it off.
It's done. I'm sure you don't need the money, but...
Well, I don't need it, but I'll tell you what, I'm more proud of what it is than what... I don't want to get the money from it, because I only use it to sue Coverdale.
Well, of course. Of course.
But, I mean, I'd like you to have a listen to it, because it is good, but, I mean, it's not the... It's no longer the lute, it's just the kudos, you know?
No, I know.
Dougie, you've heard me playing, obviously, over the last few weeks, tracks from the LP. Your honest opinion on it?
Well, I think, like, the last album that Robert did, but I never even knew it actually existed. I've got the first two. I've got Pictures at 11 and the other one that escapes me for the moment. Yeah. I don't have the third one, but I'm certainly going out tomorrow to buy Now and Zen.
Now and Zen's much more positive, I think. You know, the thing is that these guys grabbed me and they said, hey, listen, you're great, but why don't you just... sing a chorus. I said, I don't sing choruses, thank you.
That's right. I mean, I don't know what happened to the third album, but it sort of disappeared.
Hmm.
I mean, it got no publicity and it didn't get much radio airplay.
No, it's true.
But certainly, the Pictures at 11 album is an outstanding album that I really enjoy listening to, even now. And this new one, from what I've heard with Tom playing it and we listen to the other rock shows, and even the videos, you know, sitting up to 4 o'clock in the morning and catching some of the videos on the television.
Yeah, we just done a video for Torku one, which is hilarious. It's really good.
Right.
And, I think, I mean, if you listen to Doug's playing on White, Clean and Neat, it really is some kind of celebration, really. I mean, I feel that finally I can say, OK, I sang all those songs, Stairway to Heaven and all that, and so what? I've been spending so much time trying to carve a new identity for myself that I really didn't realise that the one I'd got was okay.
That's a good point. But you see, the thing about Led Zeppelin were the pinnacle of any rock music in the world that ever happened. I mean, they are responsible for so much.
Mm.
You know, you had Black Sabbath, you had Purple, you had Uriah Heep, and you had Led Zeppelin. Led Zeppelin were the pinnacle. And what I would say to you, Robert, was don't do to Led Zeppelin what Ritchie Blackmore and Gillan and all these guys have done to Purple.
No. I wouldn't dream of doing it. I mean, I thought you were going to say don't give up the day job, but... you're right, because I can't say that we were better, because it's a matter of opinion for people, you know? And as you're a musician, you develop an opinion for a different reason to some other people, you know?
Uh-huh.
But you're right. I mean, when I sing Zeppelin songs now, I sing them as a kind of celebration of my contribution to that. But the idea of staggering around the world like a bunch of old farts in bath chairs, going, oh, there's another $1 million gone, and
miss
that, and one off the wrist, thank you, miss, and then that'll be fine. I don't want to do that. I found Live Aid a bit of a contrivance.
It was good for everybody else, Robert. You know, it was good for everybody else. I went to see Zeppelin in Nebworth, and if you remember, on the first day, it was a scorching hot day.
Mm.
I ended up with sunstroke.
Oh, blimey.
So I had to leave and get hospital attendance after the first sort of hour and a quarter of the set.
Gee whiz,
So I missed the sort of highlights.
Yeah.
But,
the highlights were at the hotel afterwards, actually.
Yes, indeed. Well, that was when I was in the ambulance going back to London town.
Oh, God, that must have been... That was terrible. Yeah, it was... You know, I mean, we should... Again, you know, Nebworth was the wrong thing to do because we'd only done two gigs in Denmark before that and we were all nervous as hell. You know, we weren't a road band at that point.
Uh-huh.
It was a shame, really, because, I mean, in Denmark we were okay and we got to Nebworth and walked down that stage and there was 300,000 people and you go, what? This still goes on. You know, you never get that many at the Molyneux, even on a good day. And I thought to myself, Christ, now how can I actually fulfil anybody's expectations of the rock and roll singer when there's this much kind of blind faith and stuff, I thought it wasn't fair, or it isn't right that any human being should be put in that position of actually delivering the goods and making all the dreams weave.
But then, maybe it's not so much as delivering it, as so many people hadn't actually seen you for so long.
Yeah, it's true.
You know, that there was a lot of people there. I was there to see Zeppelin because of what they were.
Mm.
Maybe not because of what the music was for me.
No,
but just because it was an occasion. You
absolutely.
Know, it was a great occasion. Like Purple was at Nebworth in 84.
Yeah.
Or 85 or whatever it was. It was an occasion. Unfortunately, it wasn't as good as Zeppelin one was.
No.
You know?
No, it couldn't be anyway, because it kind of, in a way, they're almost doing it for the wrong reasons, I feel.
Uh-huh.
I think that... yeah, you're right, it was. It was almost like, it's like that we were the catalyst for a lot of big emotional gathering. It was very weird, really, because if you go to a contemporary concert, I think the only concert that I can say would come close to that for that reason would be U2,
right.
Where you'd go along and you'd actually be at a concert because U2 come across very harmoniously and very... very much in the way, strangely enough, that the Zeppelin audience was like.
That's right.
Where it's almost more a case of being there than actually, if Bono doesn't sing that well, or if he falls into the crowd and they don't hold him up or whatever, it doesn't matter. The thing is that you were there.
That's right. I mean, that was the whole thing for me. You know, the fact that I was there.
Mm.
I mean, the actual performance to me now is sort of, it's very vague.
Mm.
But the occasion.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
Seeing Led Zeppelin on the stage, you know, I'll live with me for the rest of my life.
I know. Well, I'll never forget it either, actually. Oh, gosh.
Of course, you'll see them on Sunday night, Dougie. Dougie, listen, thanks a lot for taking part in the programme tonight.
I'll see you in the bar.
Right, okay, thanks a lot.
Okay, mate, bye.
Thanks a lot, Dougie.
And good luck to you as well.
Right, thank you, cheers.
Robert, we better take a break. Pick me an old Zeppelin track to play.
Old Zeppelin track, The Wanton Song.
Here it is. The Wanton Song from Led Zeppelin. Our guest on the rock show tonight, Robert Plant. Robert, Zeppelin covers, we spoke 5 years ago here at Radio Clyde, launching your solo career, and at that time, no way were you going to do Zeppelin covers. Okay, everyone's entitled to change their mind. You've changed your mind,
mm-hmm.
and you've thrown in a few Zeppelin covers. I'm not going to ask you to tell us which ones. We can wait and see that tomorrow night at the gig. But when did you make that decision?
When I realised everybody else was doing them anyway. I mean, if they aren't actually covers, there's somebody else doing the same song. As we said earlier on, how many times can you hear Kashmir with different, you know? Also, I think Phil Johnston, the guy who's co-written a lot of the stuff with me, is kind of responsible for this whole thing, one way or another, for better or worse, because he said, why are you being such an old tart about it all, you know? Why don't you sing some of those songs? They're your songs as much as they're anybody else's. And it took me a great deal of deliverance and walking up and down, and deliberating, rather, to decide what to do, because if I won't go on the road with Led Zeppelin, should I still sing the songs? Well, I won't go on the road with Led Zeppelin because I don't like the kind of attention that the whole thing creates. You're no longer in charge of your own musical destiny. You're part of this incredible bandwagon sponsored by Coca-Cola or whatever it is, you know, and all that sort of... and all the kind of rock and roll chaos. Now, we've got chaos now, but this is a happy chaos. And it's born new chaos, you know? And it's not so big, and it's a bit more manageable, and the comprehension of everything. Every night I'm working to reinstate my position, which really as an individual, as a solo artist, I've never really had, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So it's all so much more exciting. And so I guess, really, to just chuck them in, say, yeah, well, I also did that, just in case you might have heard it when you were growing up from Mum and Dad, or whatever it is, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm proud of it. And I didn't realise... And my daughter said to me, her psychobilly boyfriend who'd been playing, I don't know, you know, the Milkshakes or, who were those psychobilly bands from a while back? You know, all those sort of bands playing all that kind of mad British rockabilly, suddenly started moving over to the Cult.
And I went, what? You can't go from psychobilly, which is a very British sort of anti-pop music, into the Cult. It's like, he said, she said, yeah, and he's listening to your records, Dad. And I said, don't talk saft. She said, listen, they're great. And I sat down and went, Christ, they are rather good, aren't they? Sounds really twee, but it's exactly what happened. Mm. I polished off a bottle of vodka and burst into tears.
Really?
Mm.
Where do you actually live now, Robert?
In the car. Most of the time.
No, I mean, are you UK?
Oh, yeah, yeah, I'm never anywhere else, really. Mm. Unless somebody takes me. Mm. China would be nice. Usually in London now.
No.
Mm.
Just moving on from what Dougie was saying earlier on, just a brief one. We don't want to dwell too much on the Zeppelin thing, but I thought maybe an interesting question. The highlight in your memory of your X number of years with Led Zeppelin?
Her name was Audrey Hamilton, and she lived near Dallas. And I recall refusing her entreaties and going to bed on my own. And I remember the hotel security and my security and everybody's job was to keep her out of the hotel. And I mean, I just remember the fire alarm going off and running downstairs along with everybody else and lining up outside the hotel. And there was Audrey Hamilton with her finger on the button going, I've got you now, you bastard. Things like that.
And did you ask her in for a coffee?
No, no, she stayed with Jez Woodruff, who bought her a Mexican. And then he bought her a Taiwanese.
And your highlight with your solo career, the release of Now and Then?
Seeing her again. But actually getting away this time. No, no. I don't know. I mean, I've had some real good times. I like to laugh. And I find that I'm so serious when I'm writing and I'm so concerned about it all being okay. It's such a relief when it finally gets underway. And I guess the highlight really for me was of my sort of career now, looking through these spectacles, which I don't have, is probably the second or third gig that I did with this band, which was, I think, Leicester University. And it suddenly it went into a gear that I'd never imagined that it could go into. And it was so exciting, exhilarating.
I've got a letter along there in my locker. I'm going to get it out before you go and let you see it, from somebody who was at that.
Yeah? What did they say?
Said it was good.
Don't give up the day job. It was great.
No, he says it was excellent. Yeah. I can't remember the guy's name, but I'll dig out the letter and let you see it. And he tells me all of the Zeppelin songs that you did, etc. That was the first time I knew that you were doing those Zeppelin songs.
Yeah. But it was great because it was really, really, really a composite band, you know? I met a little girl last night in Newcastle, and she said, well, I said, what do you think? She said, I thought you'd be standing on your own a lot more, you know, as a, you know, being a solo artist. And she didn't know about Led Zeppelin or anything. She just heard Heaven Knows. And she didn't really know anything about There's a Lady Who's Sure and all that. So I was like, it was a new thing. But this thing's much more of a band thing, and it was great. And I the strength in numbers now.
Have you dropped the white slippers?
No.
You're still wearing them?
Oh, yes. I've got to wash them, actually. We've got them in the car. They're going to the laundry tonight.
The number of letters I got after the Apollo performance saying it was great, apart from the white slippers.
Well, they're not white slippers, you see. What they are is they're dancing shoes. And the only way that I can get around and spin and stuff, you can't wear cowboy boots because, you know, you can if you do the sort of status quo movements, but if you're spinning around... I will, listeners, I'm awfully sorry. I'm going to dye some of them like psychedelic splashes of colour. But there's nothing effeminate about them white slippers, boy. When they come off, watch out.
Watch for out for Robert's big toe. Why, recently, some of the magazines have been obviously doing interviews with you, and it's Percy. Mm. Have they nicknamed you that for always, or is that just something new?
No, it happened in the Zeppelin days. I got the nickname.
Really?
Yeah.
I can never remember that.
Yeah. I was always Purse. Purse.
Why?
I'm not going to... family show, innit?
Yeah, but it's late, quite late at night.
Yeah, well, Purse, it's a kind of... It refers to, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah? No? No?
Well,
no.
Part of the... used to be part of the anatomy. Now I don't know where the bloody hell it's gone. Hey, by gum, laugh.
Yeah. Okay.
AIDS is something...
not for me, then.
One serious question before we wind it up, Robert. It's getting just a bit time to go home to bed. Something that's hit this the world. And someone who, like yourself, who right through the 70s enjoyed yourself as a singer of a rock and roll band. We assume you enjoyed yourself as a singer in a rock and roll band. Obviously, in the 80s, with this AIDS business, it's going to affect, I don't mean yourself, but the young bands coming through.
Just a minute, there's no difference between me and the young bands. When you're hot, you know. Well, it does affect you, but what you do is you have a hole in your pocket instead. No. Christ. Yes, it's terrible. I have to say that it's so sad. And there's nothing really, there's no kind of great overall statement about what to do or what not to do. Maybe this thing has just come along to sort of, I don't know, there's not even a point that you can say about moral, you know, slowing down the whole kind of moral collapse. Because it doesn't matter, people have been fooling around since the beginning of time, you know.
Mm.
It's just now that there's a kind of, it's not an epidemic, but it's the effect. And the kind of cause and effect is horrendous. And you're right, a rock and roll band is about like travelling salesmen. You see them all in hotels with their little badges on, but they get hot and horny at night. What are they going to do? You know?
Mm.
I think Richard Branson came up with a good idea with that mates scheme. I think that's great. And I think I was hoping... I know Phil Collins got sponsored on his American tour by Michelob, and I suggested to my manager that I could be sponsored by a condom company. I thought that would be quite appropriate for a bloke who sucked and blowed his way across the world for years and years to suddenly be, you have a free condom on each seat.
Mm.
Yeah. But I don't know. I mean, all joking apart. The more money that can actually be hived off the government to actually... find some, not about cure, but I mean protection, cure, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. There's so many things, aren't there?
Yeah. Last question, Robert, before you get home to your bed.
I'm not going to bed. Good God. I'm going to the...
Ambition, what's the main ambition that Robert Plant still has?
What, you mean that I haven't done? Well, my ambition, yeah, basically is to continue with this attitude towards what I'm doing. You know, I mean, I don't have any... I've got rid of a lot of the complexities and the kind of changes of mind and whatever it is. And if I can carry on in playing and enjoying myself the way that I do right now, I shall be overly happy. Commercial success would be very nice along with it, because I've seen it before. However, I wouldn't like it to spoil too much the way it is right now. The way it is right now is, it's very rewarding. And remember, I mean, I might be spinning around the stage in those silly white slippers, but I have been making records for 20 years, you know. And I mean, I do know the difference between happening and not happening. And this is happening.
Mm.
And I like it. And I just want, my ambition is to keep it like this and laugh a lot.
You certainly seem a happy man just now.
I've got a hole in my pocket.
Robert, thanks a lot for coming in.
It's a pleasure.
I'm looking forward to tomorrow night. Yeah. I hope you'll have as good a night as you had in Newcastle last night.
I think so, yeah.
And of course Sunday at the Playhouse.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I look forward to every day.
Robert Plant, thank you.
Thanks a lot.